So, what's this Lifecycle carbon footprint software?
Well, basically we're coming up to 2016 when all homes are supposed to be zero carbon. And by that time, all the carbon that is associated with a dwelling will be embodied within its shell. And so we think that that has got to be addressed and assessed and estimated as soon as possible. And so this model, our Lifecycle model, is going to do that, as well as taking into account the carbon that is emitted during use. And if we can strike a happy balance so that you can put enough renewable energy, methods of renewable energy generation with the dwelling to account for the carbon that is embodied within the shell and within the building elements, then we feel that is then truly zero carbon.
Okay, so essentially it tells you how much carbon is used in the construction of the building.
Yeah.
And what use is that going to be?
It allows a building designer or an architect to address it and be able to design a building with the least amount of carbon embodied within it, you know, using stuff like local materials, renewable materials, rather than energy intensive materials and materials further away. So it just minimises that carbon that is encrusted within the shell.
Okay, and what's different from this?
I think two options here. They're not best practice, because best practice would, you know, it would be, you know, ridiculous alternative material that you can't really use in mass development these days, such as like cop construction and straw bale and round earth, that kind of thing. So this, I give two options here. One is less carbon intensive, one is more carbon intensive. Both can be used for mass carbon development. So it's stuff like using recycled concrete, which uses fly ash from the generation of steel, construction of steel. It's using timber floor, straw bale insulation. It's using timber frame rather than brick and block, traditional construction. It's using timber cladding rather than brick. It's using timber windows rather than PVC frame. It's using finger truss rather than the rafters within the roof. It just minimises that embodied carbon, just so that the developer, the architect, can be taking the knowledge that he has assessed it and thought about it when designing the building. And increasingly, that is what clients and building developers are going to want to see.
Okay. So you specify a lower carbon building footprint.
Yeah.
So what does the zero carbon after mean?
Well, basically, we've assessed within a building that conforms to option one, which is constructively option one, which uses a lot of timber, timber frame, a lot of straw bales and kind of thing, as I said, recycled concrete. We've assessed the amount of carbon that is embodied within this construction, and then we've looked at how we are able to offset that carbon through renewable energy generation. So we have taken just kind of a normal house, you know, but quite energy efficient as well, maybe code level 3. We've built an energy efficient level, and we stuck in a biomass boiler, 8 square metres of solar thermal and 8 square metres of PV, and then that will produce, that will have a carbon export, so it will produce about, reduce the amount of carbon that is taken in by nearly 300 milligrams a year because of the energy that it produces. So if the carbon that's embodied within the construction is 12.3 tonnes, then that would mean that the energy that it produces, that it puts into the grid, takes away from that that would be produced, and therefore become carbon neutral after nearly 43 years. So do I like to test like that?
Yeah, so your software shows a true carbon zero.
What we would say is, yeah, true zero carbon, yeah. We're not entirely happy with the definition of zero carbon at the moment, because it doesn't take into account the whole life cycle of the building. It just takes into account the operational stage of the building. And this is what this software seeks to evaluate.
Evaluate both the operational and the